Reimaginary Boys marcó el comienzo de una larga carrera. A pesar de algunos cambios en la formación y varios dramas típicos del rock and roll, The Cure ha sabido permanecer y emerger con fuerza su dedicación por la música. Esto es Especiales Telehit y The Cure.
Pues estoy aquí con Robert Smith. Robert Smith, welcome once again to Mexico.
Thank you very much.
3 years after your last concerts here in Mexico at the Sports Palace, what would be like the best thing or the most important thing that you remember about those concerts?
The audience, actually.
Yeah.
It was quite overwhelming. We got a little taste of it yesterday again, of the intensity of Mexican audiences is quite staggering, actually. South America as a whole is without doubt the most kind of engaged and the loudest crowd that we play to anywhere in the world.
Did you change your perception about Mexico, the country, after you came here for the first time?
It's funny because we never really came to Mexico. I think the first time we ever played here was in 1992. We drove down to Monterrey and played, and then drove back almost like scared chickens. I don't know. Probably it was my fault. But then we went to Japan in 1984. We didn't go back until this year. So there are some places that I don't know. I mean, you know, we've never played in Chile. We've never played Venezuela. So we will change all that next year. I'm determined that we'll take the band to all the places that we've never been. But one, we've only been to Mexico a couple of times. It's strange, to say the least. I don't know. I haven't got a good answer for it.
You should go maybe to the south to get some vacation or something.
Probably. Yeah. The others have been, actually. The others have been here on holiday. Everyone but me has been at Alhambra. So I think that when I next come back to Mexico, I'll probably come back as a normal person.
Go to the beach. I'm not saying this because I'm Mexican, but we have like beautiful beaches where you can go
and have
fun.
I'm just trying to picture me on the beach. Though,
yeah, of course. Yeah, you should. Robert, you're going to release your 13th studio album. You're going back to the studio. And you said that this record would surprise some people because this will be like stripped down and in your face. Could you please talk us a little bit more about this record?
I think the idea of doing it as a four-piece has changed my kind of vision of what the band is. It's much better, I think, as a four-piece.
Why?
Just the dynamic's better. The four people work better together than there's no kind of dissent. There's no grumbling. There's no moaning. Everyone's got the same kind of picture in their head, and which makes the process that much easier for me. It's taken a long time. I mean, we first started on this record. We made the first recordings for it last summer, like summer 2006. And then we took a really long break when I did a live video, a live DVD video. And then we came back to it, actually a year to the day since we'd first gone, and we came back and we started recording again. So it's turned into a really big thing, a really ambitious project. It's 26 songs will be on the finished thing. So it's like an old-fashioned double album. There's a lot of words on it, and there's a lot of singing, and there's a lot of weird stuff. So it's difficult to describe what it's like. I mean, if anything, it's like anything we've done before. It's probably like the Kiss Me album that we did in the middle of the 1980s. In that it's quite sprawling. It's not like an album that has one kind of feel. You don't put it on and at the end of the hour you feel a certain way. It kind of takes you in lots of different directions. It's really good fun to do. And it's the most fun I've ever had, actually, in the studio. We're just getting to the point now where I have to kind of take it a bit more seriously and try and get it finished and working together. The individual songs, it's one thing. There are stages and finishing a song is all well and good, but then you have to kind of make the whole thing work, and it's that we're at that point. So we're re-recording a couple of things in order for it to flow a bit better. So it's kind of an ongoing process still, and although I guarantee that I'm going to hand it over at Christmas.
Oh, okay.
It seems frighteningly close, considering how much is left to do. But no, it will get done. I think Cure fans will enjoy it.
Is it true that you're going to include some of old songs that you recorded at the beginning of the 80s and you're going to release it in this album?
There is what we did three, actually, that I found when I've been going through the our tapes for the re-releases. I've been putting together the extras discs for all the old albums as they come out. And I came across three songs which I thought were really good, actually, and that weren't used, not because they weren't good, but because they didn't fit what we were doing at the time. So I kind of kept them to one side and thought, we'll use those in the next record. As it turns out, only one of them's worked. The other two have kind of, like, they haven't really, you know, I couldn't write to them, I couldn't write words to them. But one of them's really good. And it sounds like old Cure. It's very strange, actually.
Wow.
But then quite a few of the things, I suppose with hindsight, because I was doing all this, the re-release stuff, I think I was kind of hearing things about old Cure that I really liked. So there's a lot more kind of six-string bass in there, and there's some very basic piano stuff, because I used to play all the keyboards, and I've kind of gone back to playing the keyboards again in the studio.
So wow.
It's a very weird mix of stuff, actually, thinking about it.
But it sounds great, really.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult to describe because it isn't one thing. It's like, there's a song on there that's probably like the happiest song I've ever written in my life. And there's also the saddest song I've ever written, so it's kind of a little weird mix.
It's like real polarized.
It's like, it's kaleidoscopic. Go on in a bad way.
Okay.
I need about an hour of sleep. I apologise to the viewers for being
No, it's okay. It's okay, don't worry about it.
I'm sure they know how I feel.
No.
Estás viendo a The Cure, en especial este elegir. Estás viendo a The Cure, en especial este elegir.
Robert, now that we're talking about old times, we're going back on time. Let's remember 1976, Easy Cure, all these punk explosions, the music scene, all the social revolution in England. Then you played with Siouxsie and the Banshees. What would be like the thing that you miss the most about that time?
Apart from my youth.
Yeah.
I think it was probably one of the few times that they happen very occasionally when there's a mood in a country where you can genuinely affect change. I think the problem with the punk movement was that it burnt itself out far too quickly, and it was really only to do with music. It was kind of squashed. There was a social component to what was going on, but it wasn't really squashed. It was cleverly manipulated, as is often the way.
The media.
Yeah, they played a big part in kind of diffusing a lot of the unrest. And there have been genuine revolutions since that I've witnessed, not firsthand, but kind of been, you know, like the fall of the Berlin Wall and stuff. I mean, I can remember going and playing in East Germany when we had to go through this no man's land and stuff. So when that came down, it was a big thing. You think that the world's changing. And for a brief period in 1976, it kind of felt actually more the summer of 1977, really, in the Queen's Jubilee. There was a brief period where I felt like there was a youth movement that was genuinely going to change things. And did change things with regards to the music industry, but didn't really change very much with hindsight. But, you know, it's always the way that the world's run by very clever and very horrible people.
Yeah,
generally.
And, it's always so.
But, you know, I mean, I think it opened the doors to a lot of people to do different things, and I suppose creatively it worked. But, it was probably a missed opportunity, I suppose. I mean, we benefited from it because it allowed us to. I mean, probably without the punk thing happening, we wouldn't have got signed, because up until that point, the music business was very, very strictly controlled, and it was all about big bands and everything was kind of big. So it turned it on its head, and it made everyone feel that they could do it, you know, that you didn't have to be good to do it.
Yeah.
There was an awful lot of rubbish. But, it was good to be at the age I was. I was 17, turned to 18, 1977. It's a perfect time for me. But there have been a couple of times since then where there have been cultural shifts, musical shifts. I mean, the dance thing was a big deal. But there hasn't really been another really sense of movement. I thought there was going to be one around the Iraq War, actually. I kind of got the feeling that something was going to happen in the country in England, but it never did. The English way, yes.
Estás viendo a The Cure, en especial este elegido.
How do you say England now, after all these years?
I'm not sure there is. I mean, I despair. I always have really despaired about how that year on year the media kind of manipulates the whole populaces more and more efficiently. And England has just turned into, like, unfortunately, it's a dumbed down nation if you judge it by what the most popular TV programmes are. What the most popular newspapers are. It's an awful place to be, but within the 60 or so million people, there are a lot of good people, a lot of good things happening. unfortunately, there's a, you know, there always has to be an enemy. It's one of the, it's like the curse of the modern world. There always has to be an us or them, and it's really tiring actually for me to grow up and grow older in an environment where you can see that there doesn't have to be an enemy, but there always is, and it's just, you know, it's like, it's kind of relentless and slightly disturbing, I suppose, but it's all right. I mean, it's a better place to live than a lot of other places, but it's it's not as good as it should be. But where is? You
know? I mean, at least you don't have like war, you know, physically as other countries.
Yeah, yeah. But it's the goals of using British society as an example of Western culture. The goals that are set are just wrong. You know, that people aspire to the wrong things. They aspire to this. They aspire to doing interviews. They aspire to celebrity and all that goes with it. And believe me, it's rubbish. But that's it. Yeah. Interview.
No.
I mean, it's one thing. Like, I don't mind. I do this because it's part of why I'm in The Cure. Why I sing is because I really enjoy creating music that touches other people. Right? It's an engagement with other people on the planet. This side of it is genuinely idiotic. You know, the talking side of it and the celebrity part. It's just part of what I do, but. For an awful lot of people, this is the part that matters. It's being in front of the camera that matters, and it isn't at all. It's genuinely rubbish. Yeah. The part that matters is the making music part. It's the creative part. But if I don't do this, someone else will. That's a bit like the reason for going to war. Right?
But Robert, now that we're talking about celebrity and music and all that, since you started The Cure, how has been like? What would be like the most difficult thing for you about fame? You as a person, as Robert James Smith, from a personal point of view?
I would never complain about it because it's a choice that I've made. I think the people that complain about being famous, again, they're stupid because it's very easy to walk away from if you want to, you know, you're fed up with it. The Cure became popular very slowly. We had like probably 4 or 5 albums and we've been around the world like 2 or 3 times. Before anyone knew who we were, you know, there were a small bunch of people wherever we'd go, you'd come and see us, and it kind of built and built and built. So by the time we suddenly became, you know, well known, which was like in the middle of the 80s, I'd seen a lot, and I kind of knew what was out there and what was going on. So I was prepared for it, I was mentally prepared, because it was incremental, and as it happened. I remember, funny enough, we were talking yesterday, the first time I walked out into a balcony in Paris, we were in a hotel in Paris. And there were people outside saying my name. That was the first time I suddenly became aware that we'd taken a step up. Oh, and, you know, and it was a strange feeling. But as it goes on, you just get used to it, really. I mean, it's still odd. People come up to me and they know who I am. That's actually the strangest part, and I have no idea who they are. It's a weird thing to get used to. It's weighted in their favour. They feel like they know me, and I have no idea who they are. It is unnatural, that part of it. Yeah, I mean, the rest of it, what goes on? When I'm with the group, when I'm doing something with the group, I just take it as, you know, that's part of what I do. It's still, I suppose, if I'm being honest, it's kind of difficult. I've lived in the same place now for almost 20 years, and there are still people who stop and stare. You know, it doesn't seem odd, because they've seen me all the time, but, you know.
Esto es Especial Telehit y The Cure. Estás viendo a The Cure en Especial Telehit. Continuamos.
What would be like the best thing for you of being part of The Cure and the worst thing being part of a band?
The worst part of to do this. Seriously. At this moment. I think that there isn't really a worse part, because I do it because I want to, and I'm in a position where I'm very lucky in that I've spent my entire adult life doing something I always wanted to do when I was young, so I could never complain about it. You know, there are certain aspects of what we do that are kind of harder work than you think they are. I really don't enjoy travelling very much, and there's a lot of travel.
Yeah,
and it's kind of
you get tired,
particularly
you miss
nowadays
home,
when you go through like this endless, you know, security procedures to get anywhere. So it's kind of like it's really boring, but it's not. You know, if that's all I've got to complain about, it's pretty good, isn't it? The best part of being in The Cure is being in The Cure. You know, I wouldn't want to be in any other band. I wouldn't want to do anything else. So We have time off now, which we didn't. The first 15 years of the band, it was very, very. It was full on. It was really intense. And year on year, we were relentless, really, because that's how I was. I think in the second 15 years of the band, I've been a lot more kind of relaxed about it, I suppose. When we do it, I'm very intense, but I make sure that I have time off to do other things. So I think I'm probably I'm a more rounded person than I used to be. And hopefully that hasn't impacted too much on how I feel about what I do. I actually think it's helped because I can't, you know, there are one or two bands, there's not that many bands as old as us, I suppose, now, but there are one or two who just kind of keep going. You think, like, how can you do that? It's like, you need to take time off to do something else in order to come back to this and enjoy it, you know. I think if I was to do this over and over, and I know what I'm doing in, like, in a year's time, it would really, you know, it would be too much. It's great when you're young, but as you get older, you have to kind of engage in other areas of life because you run out of time, basically. So, but I do, you know, as a job, it takes some beating.
Estás viendo a The Cure, en especial este hit.
You have more than 30 years of career as The Cure. And what would be, like, the best thing you have learned during all these years? What keeps you also doing music, you know, with your mates, with Simon, with Poro?
The things I've learned. I found myself at about 6 o'clock this morning actually speaking words of wisdom to someone. Total rubbish. I don't think I've learned as much as I should have. Don't go out before a show. That's one of the things I've learned.
Really?
Don't say all night when you're doing interviews. That's something I should have learned, but I haven't. I don't know, really. I think that the enjoyment I derive from what I do is constant. I think if I didn't feel that about, you know, if I didn't look forward to doing this, I wouldn't do it. I don't have to do it. It's, and I think it's the same. Occasionally the group changes personnel, and that's really, a lot of that's to do with the drive that's within the group. It has to be that. There has to be this sort of like sense that we're trying to create something that will be the best thing we've ever done. There has to be that idea that when we go on stage on Saturday, like tomorrow, it has to be the best show we've ever done. There has to be that continual drive to be better than we've ever been. If you sit back for a second and you think that's it, we've done it, it's you have to stop. And that's what I've always believed. It's like, I think it's true. I mean, I think that the if you feel satisfied, it means that you've reached the end. So I'm eternally dissatisfied. Well, maybe I'm not eternally. That's a bit of a rash statement. I feel constantly dissatisfied, and that kind of motivates me to do something more. So,
yeah.
But it's enjoyment, really. I mean, but the bottom line is that I really love what I do. I wouldn't want to do it. I've toyed with the idea of another thing.
Most important thing.
And I can't think of anything I'd rather do. It's a bit too late to be a footballer.
It's never too late.
Not judging by England's latest performances, I could probably get in the team. Actually.
Finally, I have to say this. One of the things that I admire more about The Cure is that you still, after 30 years, are creating like very great songs. And I think that you're really loyal to what you think, your beliefs, your image. And just, I want to know, how do you get to do this?
I suppose that when we started the group, I had an idea in my head of what I wanted to do. And it wasn't to be a famous person. I never had that in my mind. I wanted to be in a group that I would listen to and that I would want to be in. That was always my goal. So I've kind of kept that with me. And when I look at The Cure and I kind of take a step back, I think I need this group to be the group that I want to be in. And it's that, I suppose, that the others trust my intuition. I mean, they trust my judgment. Sometimes it's not. Yeah, sometimes they shouldn't, but generally I work on my instincts. I think if it doesn't feel right, it shouldn't. It isn't right, and that's how we do things. So there are easier routes to get where we've got, but I don't think there are many more satisfying routes than achieving success on your own terms, which is essentially what I always wanted. I thought I'd rather it went horribly wrong in the way that I wanted it to go horribly wrong than go right on someone else's terms. And I suppose in some ways you could think we've been fortunate, but I actually think that if people were a little bit, if they worked a bit harder at achieving what they wanted to achieve, they would probably get there. Because there's a lot of work gone into what we do. It hasn't just kind of happened. But if you enjoy what you do, you never really see it as hard work. You know, it's because at the end of it, there's this idea that you're creating something that other people will be a part of. And it's the sense of community as well. That when we go and play shows around the world, you get like a whole room full of like-minded people. It's a really great feeling. It's like it's unlike anything else you can experience. And it's, you know, there are lots of elements that will go into like making the Cure something. And I would feel I was being like traitorous if I kind of took anything away from that. If I changed it and I knew I was doing something wrong, I would feel like I betrayed everything that I started out wanting to do.
Okay.
So it's a loyalty to the idea.
Robert, finally, I want to give you a present. I bought it for you. It's a pretty Mexican. I didn't want to give you tequila because have you heard about mezcal? Have you tried it?
I have actually, unfortunately.
It's a pretty Mexican beverage with a warm inside. You should eat it.
Yeah. Yes. I'll make sure that I'm not the last one.
No, yeah, make sure of that. I've never tried it, but...
Have you not eaten not?
No. I liked mezcal, but not the worm.
I have eaten the worm once, and I think once is enough for any lifetime.
Yeah, it's enough. I think so, too.
But thank you very much. It's very kind.
No, maybe not. You could have that souvenir in your house or something.
Maybe Monday night I'll drink it.
Okay, thank you very much. Esto fue una entrevista con Robert Smith. Muchas gracias.